Hi, we're here at Dolligay Reservoir in South Wales, and today we're going to do a bit of feeder fishing. So with the increasing popularity of like natural venues, and especially feeder fishing on natural venues, we thought we'd come to Dolligay Reservoir in South Wales. It's a picturesque place, ram full of fish, and we're going to do a bit of feeder fishing and hopefully catch some nice skimmers and bream. Just going to have a little recast. We are at the shallow end of the reservoir. The reservoir sort of drops throughout the summer as both reservoirs, sort of Dolligay feeds into Pondstickle Reservoir, and then Pondstickle Reservoir feeds the whole of Cardiff with water. So throughout the summer, it's constantly dropping. And as you can see from the bit behind me, dropped quite a lot, and there's a lot of mud on show. So we are at the shallow end of the reservoir, like I said. It's probably only 3.5, 4 foot deep up here. The carp anglers always seem to fish this sort of shallower end, and they always put a lot of bait in to try and catch the carp, because there's carp to 30, 40 pound in here. So hopefully those skimmers and bream will be at this end, and we'll catch it with the cameras. So as there's a lot of carp anglers fish this reservoir, the bait choice sort of reflects that, and I've gone for quite a fish mealy ground bait, F1 dark and original Thatcher's, sort of a 70-30 mix, 70% F1 dark and 30% Thatcher's. I've also done some fin perfect 2mm micros, just because, like I said, as there's a lot of carp anglers on you, just want to put that sort of little bit of pellet through the feeder with the ground bait, as well as your normal worms, casters, and I got some fluoro maggots as well. So I'm going to be putting little blobs of worm through the feeder with the ground bait and the micro pellets, and a few casters as well. Just to start with, through a cage, just to try and build a bit of a peg. And as the fishing sort of develops, we can see what those fish sort of want, and then we can change feeders and the feed in, and how you're introduced in the feed throughout the day. So that's how I'm going to start my sort of session, is through a little cage feeder. I have put 4 sort of bait up feeders out at the start, and then I've just started with a little Friole 25 gram Preston cage. I'm going to start on that now and see how the fishing develops, because sometimes the fish are right on top of that sort of, whoop, I've got a fish there. Sometimes the fish are right on top of that sort of feeder. And when they're right on top of the feeder, sometimes it's a case of shortening your hook length, putting a window on, and sort of, oh, snag me up, whatever. Just gone into a snag, I wouldn't have there then. Feels a slightly better fish, but it's hard to tell because the water's quite shallow. And like I said, he's fishing wild natural fish. Even sort of small 10 ounce to a pound skimmers, they fight really, really hard. And they go off quite sort of violently. That's why it's important to have the right gear. So I'm fishing braid, 010 braid, and I'm fishing a 30 inch, which my feeder's running on. So there's not a lot of sort of give on these, on that sort of setup. So it's very important to have a soft, forgiving rod. And this sort of SL, lovely little fish here, look. This SL gives you that sort of softness that it just absorbs all those sort of lunges that those fish are sort of giving you. This SL is just brilliant for absorbing them and just allows you not to pull out the fish, allows you not to break your hook lengths. Really is a brilliant piece of kit, this sort of fishing. So I'm just putting a little blob of worm in, a few casters, a few micros in with the ground bait. Just put a whole worm on that time. So I'm just sinking a braid. There's a little bit of a toe on today, because it is shallow, like I said. It's important to try and make that braid go down. Also, when you're reservoir fishing, just have an atomizer by the side of you. Not only is it good for altering the consistency of your ground bait, you mean slopping it up if you're looking to try and drag fish into your peg. It's very, very good for wetting your braid. When you're continuously casting, you don't want to be ending up with a wind knot or a bird's nest where your braid's gone dry. Just by keeping it wet, keeps that sort of smoothness of when you're casting, stops you from getting tangles. So that's very important, that is. Just keep one of them on your side tree. Just keeps your fishing nice and smooth. And like I said, you can use it as well to alter your consistency of your ground bait if needed. Because this is, you know, a natural venue. These fish are wild. They're not just going to be there all day catching on one sort of mix and putting your bait in the same way all the time. You've got to sort of mix it up. Sometimes you've got to slop your ground bait up and try and drag fish into your swim. Other times you've got to sort of fish more particles where you're feeding through a window feeder. It's very important to sort of keep changing with the way the fish are changing their feeding. And hook length sizes as well, changing your hook length sizes. I mean, sometimes a meter is brilliant when fish are taking, what's another one here? Sometimes a meter is brilliant when you're catching fish off the bottom, catch them on the drop and stuff. And then other times, like I said earlier, when these fish are like right on your feeder and right on the bait, you know, a short is sort of a 6-inch hook length, can be really mega at times. Feels another half tidy fish. Not as big as the last one, but another nice skimmer. One thing I will say with sort of this natural reservoir sort of fishing, a lot of people say to me, oh, I can't do that. It's too specialist. It doesn't have to be. It doesn't have to be specialist. You know, you can go to these natural venues. Like this is an 11-foot SL. I'm only chucking sort of 35, 40 yards. It doesn't have to be specialist. I got a bit of braid on, a cage feeder. The hook lengths I'm using is a N30 size 12. Ready tied, straight out of the packet. No messing. And I just cut them down to size. They come in a metre. So I can either have a metre tail or I can cut it down to size. I've cut this one down to half a metre. And I've got one as well on my side tray that I cut down to sort of 8-inch, 10-inch, just in case those fish start really having a go and really sort of getting right on the feed. I'm just getting a few indications at the moment. Like there's fish in the peg, but not really getting their heads down. It is shallow, like I said, and when it's gin clear, when the sun came out just a minute ago, bites and indications sort of stopped for a little bit. But they've just started to come back now as there's been a bit of the wind's picked up a little bit, there's a little bit more of a ripple on it, and the sun's just gone down behind the clouds a little bit. What I've noticed is, especially up here, when I've been fishing the matches and the festivals, is when those little perch start becoming a pain, when you're fishing sort of a big worm, a whole worm, or two tails of a worm and stuff like that, they seem to, anything that's sort of wriggling or causing vibrations, yeah, straight away look. Anything that causes vibrations, like a big worm or tails of worms, those perch are straight on them. And just by putting the head of a worm on, it doesn't wriggle, it doesn't move, there's no vibrations off it. Just seems to like go down and gives you a bit more of a chance of getting these sort of bigger skimmers. You still catch perch on it, don't get me wrong, but you're just giving yourself a little bit more chance of not catching one. Another. Another skimmer. Slightly bigger than the last one, but certainly not the biggest one in here. If anyone in sort of the South Wales area, or you know, close to the South Wales area, sort of watching this video and thinking what a beautiful place, I wouldn't mind having a go at it. It's controlled by Murfa Angling Alliance. So you can get day tickets and you can get season tickets on you. They got lots of waters. They control both of the reservoirs, this one and the one next door. Pond stickle. Another bite. There is a bit of a snag. But there he is again, look. It's a little bit of a snag about 10 metres back from where I'm fishing. There is like an old riverbed that sort of runs from up in our corner and runs down here, down to the bottom of the dam. And when we do get a lot of rain, there's some trees and stuff like that that does does come down into the reservoir. I don't know whether you can, see, there's a few big trees sticking out of the water. So there is a few snags about. So we've been fishing about an hour now. And although the fishing's not been hectic, what we've noticed is you're having quite a few indications and they're not turning into bites. So what that tells me is I've been putting little blobs of worm in the cage feeder, and my thought process now and what I'm thinking is that those fish are like attacking the feeder to try and get to those little bits of worm. So just swapped to a window feeder and a short hook length. So just swapped to a solid window feeder and I'm filling it with just neat worm and just plugging the top of it with a little bit of ground bait. I've got a little perch there. Perhaps that's what's giving us those bites. There's a lot of indications, and if those little perch are attacking the feeder, that's what's giving me those little bites and those little indications and not turning into anything. So at least by doing this, you know what fish are either being a nuisance, you can try and change your feeding to get rid of them or avoid them, or try and catch the fish that are actually on that feeder. But like I said, what it seemed was, and what my thought process was, I was getting lots of indications. As soon as the feeder was hitting the bottom, lots of indications, yeah, straight away, look. Another little perch, so I think they are the fish that are sort of causing those bites and those indications. They were like right on the feeder when I was fishing the cage feeder. And because I had a longer hook length and the worm was like falling a little bit further away, didn't seem like I was getting any bites. You were sort of sat on your hands waiting, but like lots of indications and no bites. Where it just shows, just by switching feeders, switching to a solid window, little 30 gram one, just putting neat worm in it, just topping, plugging it off with a little bit of ground bait, and a little 10 inch hook length. It just resulted in two fish really, really quickly, which seemed to be the fish that were giving me those bites I couldn't hit. So perhaps it's a case now that those bigger skimmers and bream have sort of maybe moved off a little bit, and I gotta do something to bring them back. Because if these little perch are here and they're causing a bit of a nuisance, then I might have to do something to try and bring those skimmers and bream back. See, that's not a perch, that's a skimmer. And that was exactly the same, like right on the feeder, so. Tells me that those fish are after the bait. They're obviously hungry and after the bait. And they're literally right on the feeder. Now sometimes when it's really, really good, you can go down as far as like a 6-inch hook length sometimes. You know, when you can have a mega day's fishing, it's literally going around as soon as it's hitting the bottom. But it's a little skimmer that time. It does seem to be a lot of fish, you know, after those worms, like. So it's clear that they won those worms and they won those particles. So we'll have another chuck on that. It's a good little demonstration of how sometimes you get lots of indications and lots of bites. You know, you never put anything in the net. Where a little switch of feeder, and then your hook length can just start putting those fish that you're missing out on in your net. It's very important, like I said at the start of the video, it's very important to sort of keep swapping hook length sizes. You know, keep swapping sort of feeders as well, and hook baits and stuff, and the way you're introducing your bait. Because sometimes you can't stay on that one. There's another fish there. Can't stay on that one way of introducing your bait and feeding all day. You've got to keep swapping it and changing it. Like I said, these are wild fish, natural fish, and they wise up quite quickly. I mean, if they start getting caught on a certain way, they soon wise up to it, and you've got to sort of change to continue catching. So we've just been fishing probably, I don't know, 2.5 hours now, and it's been all right. It hasn't been brilliant, but it's been all right. And we just, I just missed a bite then. It's just gone a bit quiet. I don't know why. The skimmers and the bream sort of tailed off a bit, and we started catching a few perch. And then all of a sudden, it's just gone really, really quiet. So what I've done is I've just unclipped and taken literally 5 turns off the spool, which is only sort of like 0.5 metre. So I've just done that. I chucked out, and it went around straight away with a sort of a pound skimmer. So what I've done now is I'm just going to keep stick on that line now, because sometimes they just back off and you've got to keep chasing them. You know, we have added quite a few of them. So I don't know whether they've just backed off, but the bite's really, really slowed up. You know, we were casting and you were waiting ages for a bite, and when you did get one, it was a little perch. But first cast on that line and never had a bite after unclipping. And second cast has gone round and I've had a sort of a pound skimmer. And I've just missed an indication then. I probably struck a little bit early on that one, but just missed an indication then. So we'll have another couple of casts on this now. Oh, that was a big line bite then. Probably shouldn't have picked up on that one. That's a big line bite. I don't know whether it was a pike close in, or maybe even a carp. There's some big carp in you. I've never cast on that line there now, because although I couldn't get bites on my original line, we've had a couple of indications now off that new line. Even though it's only 0.5 metre to 1 metre further out, because it's a new line, they just feel a little bit more confident on it. We've had a few more indications now since we've gone past our initial feed. Granted, I've missed two sort of really off the rest bites. You swear we're on a method on a carp venue, but just shows that they've... But there we go, we got one. And it's another skimmer, so just shows they are there. They just, you know, I could have carried on for another 15-20 minutes on that initial feed, and and not caught anything. And I've unclipped, like I said, only half a meter to a meter. And straight away you're into fish. You know, second cast I had one, it was probably a pound. I missed those two line bites. I got this one, which is probably 8 to 10 ounces. You know, nice little skimmer there. So 8 to 10 ounce fish. Just goes to show that if you're not catching, even if it's a line you were catching on sort of earlier in the day and you've got confidence in, if you're not catching, just unclip and go that little bit past, because sometimes that does make a difference. You know, another cast there now. You know, some matches they'd fish, you might have to unclip sort of four or five, maybe six times, and keep sort of chasing those fish. You might only catch like one or two fish every time you do it. And you might have to do it again and again and again to keep those fish coming. Like I said, it is shallow here today, you know, so. There we go. See, that's worked a treat out of. I mean, just going past, considering I wasn't getting any bites, and then just by going past that little bit, past that initial feed, it's got me three really quick fish. You know, three fish in five casts. And these are sort of the decisions and the things that you do in a match that make a difference. It's another 6 to 8 ounce fish. So we've had a really good day here today, really good session, and although we're on our own and sort of pleasure fishing, because it is a natural venue, we've been able to show you different sort of things that happen when you're fishing. So like the different lengths of hook lengths, you know, the different feeders, when fish sort of get on that sort of bait on the feeder. So they're right on it, and how to shorten your hook lengths up, how to change the window feeders to feed sort of neat particles like worms and casters. And even when the swim sort of died and sort of started going away from us really, just the sort of unclipping of your line and moving that sort of meter further out, how the difference that can make when you trying to put those extra fish in your net. You know, it's a beautiful, beautiful place, beautiful scenery. And I hope you enjoy the video. If you do like sort of these videos and you're interested, like and subscribe to the Preston YouTube channel. And there'll be loads and loads of content like this going on there for you guys to enjoy. I was hoping to end on a fish. but they've just tailed off a little bit again. So we might, oh, and there we are, right on cue. Right on cue to end the video. And it's our last skimmer of the day. So I'll just get this one in. And we'll call it a day, I think. We have had a couple. You see that? Pike's just bit through. Look. There's the head. So there we are, cracking day, Dolligay Reservoir, South Wales, right at the bottom of the Brecon Beacons. And we're going to call that a day. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you enjoyed the video. Like and subscribe to the Preston YouTube channel for loads more content like this.